Cassette number 11 from the Waiting on God held in Jeffersonville, Indiana, June of 1976. This continues from tape number 9, the morning session on Thursday, June 24th.
Brother Morgan, would you give the message?
Shall we bow our heads and just... a word of prayer. Our dear Father, we come acknowledging our great need of Thee.
Yes, very much, Jesus.
We come asking for a new anointing from heaven and for divine illumination upon the Word. Give us understanding hearts, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I want us to turn to 2 Samuel, the 18th chapter, and begin reading with the 19th verse. 2 Samuel, the 18th chapter, and begin reading with the 19th verse. Then said Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok, "Let me now run and bear the king tidings, how that the Lord hath avenged him of his enemies." See, the story here, of course, is the story of Absalom's rebellion against the king. And when Absalom had been killed, destroyed, it was necessary to send word to David the king. And that's what this scripture is about. And Joab said unto him, "Thou shalt not bear tidings this day, but thou shalt bear tidings another day. But this day thou shalt bear no tidings, because the king's son is dead." Then said Joab to Cushai, "Go tell the king what thou hast seen." And Cushai bowed himself unto Joab and ran. Then said Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok, yet again to Joab, "But howsoever, let me, I pray thee, also run after Cushai." Joab said, "Wherefore wilt thou run, my son, seeing that thou hast no tidings ready?" "But howsoever," said he, "let me run." And he said unto him, "Run." Then Ahimaaz ran by way of the plain and overran Cushai. And David sat between the two gates, and the watchman went up to the roof over the gate of the wall and lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, a man running alone. And the watchman cried and told the king, and the king said, if he be alone, there is tidings in his mouth. And he came apace and drew near, and the watchman saw another man running. And the watchman called unto the porter and said, "Behold, another man running alone." And the king said, "He also bringeth tidings." And the watchman said, "Methinks the running of the foremost is like the running of Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok." And the king said, "He's a good man, and come with good tidings." And Ahimaaz called and said unto the king, "All is well." And he fell down to the earth upon his face before the king, and said, "Blessed be the Lord thy God, which hath delivered up the men that lifted up their hands against my lord the king." And the king said, "Is the young man Absalom safe?" And Ahimaaz answered, "When Joab sent the king's servant, and me thy servant, I saw a great tumult, but I knew not what it was." The king said unto him, "Turn aside and stand here." And he turned aside and stood still, and behold, Cushai came. And Cushai said, "Tidings, my lord the king, for the Lord hath avenged thee this day of all them that rose up against thee." And the king said unto Cushai, "Is the young man Absalom safe?" And Cushai answered, the enemies of my lord the king and all that rise against thee to do thee hurt be as that young man is. And the king was much moved and went up to his chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went thus, he said, O, my son Absalom, my son Absalom, would God I had died for thee, O Absalom, my son, my son. I trust we get the simplicity of this little message today. Here is, of course, a great tragic hour when David's son had rebelled against him and to take over the kingdom, and the soldiers of David went out to conquer in battle. But he said, be careful of my son Absalom. Well, you know the story. You remember reading it. Absalom was slain, and now it became necessary to send word back to David that Absalom had been killed. And so Joab, it was necessary for him to choose a runner to run, and of course the greatest runner of all came up and said, let me run. This fellow, Ahimaaz, no doubt had established a great reputation as a runner, and he knew that he could probably outrun anybody. He said, let me run. I'll run. I'm the best runner around here. I'll get there the fastest of anybody. Let me run. And Joab said, you'll not run today. Now, there may be another day you'll run, but not today. You won't run today. And then Joab turned around and got a fellow that couldn't run very good. Said, here, Cushai, you run. He couldn't run very well. He probably never ran and won a race in his life. And he said, I want you. This is an important day and a great message, but I want you to carry the message. And so he bowed his head and took off. Now, the important thing, I want you to see something. The important thing was not the fellow who could run the fastest, but the important thing was the man who would be careful with the message. Amen. So Cushai ran, but Ahimaaz, why, he knew he could run better than Cushai, and he begged Joab. He said, let me run. Just please, let me run. Joab said, why do you want to run? You don't have a message. Why do you want to run? He just said, oh, please, let me run. And Joab finally said, all right, go ahead and run. And I tell you, he took off a running. He was a beautiful runner. This man could run. No doubt he'd run, established a reputation in races, and came away with trophies, and you should have seen him taking off. I tell you, he took off after that Cushai, and he passed him up down on the plain of flying and left old Cushai way back there. And I tell you, when he got near the gate, the watchman saw a fella coming running, said, I tell you, here he comes. Here comes a fella running. And I said, he said, I can recognize that. Look at that. He said, I tell you, he's running like Ahimaaz. Only one fellow runs like that. That's beautiful. Great runner. Yeah, I said, he knew right away. He said, it's who he's running like. Look at that. You can tell who that runner is. I tell you, that's beautiful. And he said to David, I tell you, looks like Ahimaaz. And he said, well, he's a good man. He's a good man, and I tell you, he's a good runner. And when he finally, he said, there's another one coming too. Both of them alone, they must have message. So I tell you, Ahimaaz, this great runner outran the one that had the message. He got there first and came in, and so he wanted to give his message. And here he was. He arrived first on the scene. He outran Cushai, and there he came. He said, all right, what is it? Well, he said, I tell you, he said, when I saw Grade went out there. He said the battle was going, and he said, I saw a great tumult, but he said, I really don't know what it was all about. He got there first, but he said, all I can report is a great tumult, a great commotion, he said. There was a great commotion, but I don't really know what it was about. And finally, here come a puffing in a little bit later on, Cushai coming, and he got there late. He wasn't a very good runner. But said, you got any word? What happened? He said, and he was able to give the message to the king. He said, may all your enemies be as that young man is. David got the message.
He got it.
And he said, oh, my son Absalom.
Yeah.
Absalom, my son.
Yes.
What I want you to see today is that for every situation in a meeting, God has a man to deliver the message. He has a man to deliver a song, and God gives that person the message. Now, there may be others that can outrun him. There may be others that are more beautiful singers. But it isn't the one that's the most beautiful singer or the best preacher. It's the one that God's given the message to. Isn't that something? And that's why Brother Helm will say, well, here, this fellow over here, you're to lead the singing, and it might be somebody like Brother Rhyme who's never led before.
Right. Yeah.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
As far as the singing. Now, he said, you'll sing another day, and it may be a great singer. God may give the message to them, or he may not. But it's whoever God gives the message to that Brother Helm is trying to say, now, the one that's got the message right now from the Lord, you come. Now, it may not be the one that has the most beautiful form, the most beautiful voice, but he'll have the message.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
If he gets up here and doesn't have the message, all he can report is, well, there was a great commotion, and I really don't know what it's all about. But it's important, you see, that we listen to Brother Helm and let God him say, now, this is the one that's got the message for us, and we better listen, because maybe he isn't the best preacher, maybe the best singer, but if we'll listen, the message is there.
Yes, sir.
And we'll know what the message is from God, and it'll be more than the promoting of just a great tumult or a great commotion.
True.
What a tragic thing to go into a service and be able to come out where nobody's had the message, never been sent by God, nothing is of God, and all you can report, what about the message? Well, I tell you, there was a great commotion, but I really don't know what it was all about. But when we can get into a simple little service, it may be a child, it may be somebody who can't sing very good, somebody who can't preach very good, but when we come out, we've had a message from God.
Amen.
That's what we want. So if we'll just wait, and I think it's beautiful, there's a quiet restfulness of God's people waiting for God's message that I've seen here, which is so beautiful, and it seems like these dear people are getting more handsome and beautiful as time goes on. I was sitting over here and just across from Joe and Betty, and they were a lovely couple years ago when I met them in Logansport, but I just admired, look, they get more handsome, it seems like, as time goes on, there's the quiet restfulness that's in the face, waiting just simply on God, not trying to say, brother, come on, let's get this thing a-running. We want a fast runner today. And I tell you, if we get the fast runner today and he has no message for us, just the commotion. That's all we can report. But if we wait quietly from God and let him just say, now, this one is the one that has a message now, we'll be able to report and go out and say, I tell you, God's message, this was God's message. That's what we're wanting, and I'm thankful that God's helping us to wait quietly to get God's man. Glory
so
to
precious,
God.
So
bless
precious.
The Lord. So just have that little result.
Brother, Reverend Oliver Hope just gave me a wonderful report a while ago. It's a marvelous experience. Yes. Would you like to come and give it to the people for the dear ones sing? Yes, that's it.
Brother Jones met me in the hall just after the last session and shared that last night when Brother Helm was praying for the back area here, that his wife had two open places running as a result of sugar, bad sugar problem, and the Lord came and touched her and healed her, and they're dried up today.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for doing it, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. She was examined. One of you in the audience is a nurse, and made that examination, also a qualified nurse somewhere in this audience, examined her body, and we received that good report.
And as you gave that to me, I was thrilled.
Oh, praise the Lord.
I was thrilled. The Holy Spirit witnessed to me.
It's wonderful.
Praise the Lord. We're so indebted to you.
Brother Helm, I remember when you were sharing about the money. Of course, the offering was already taken, and so many stories are shared on you if people really knew that the Holy Spirit was the one speaking, if you're around him a while in the room or wherever, I always advise people to come and see, because that's when you're speaking of the kingdom of God, about all you can say is what Philip said to Nathaniel, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? And this is not the Christ, but the Christ dwells within him. Can any good thing come out of Parker, Indiana? Seems to be the big question today. All I can say to people, come and see. Amen. And for the Lord himself said in the book of Malachi, prove me now herewith, saith the Lord, if I will not prove myself. And do remember that 1 year the board gave me a wonderful raise, comparably throughout the church world, who were so far beneath God's standards. And I was excited about it. And it was early in my ministry, and it was a $25 raise. And, of course, God sent me to Scott Depot one night after praying with him in Florida. That's how I got there, through the witness of the Holy Ghost. I don't think I'd ever had the inner witness at that time that I remember. Right. And God permitting, which he did, because I have prayed with him, he couldn't say anything, couldn't tell me, or God did not permit him to pray with me. For we prayed together when he said, Lord, can we pray about this or not? God said, no, so we can't pray about it. And I had to wait. Maybe the answer came to me somewhere along the line or in prayer with others. But that night, God let us pray. How grateful do you think I am that the Holy Spirit witnessed to this brother when I had never had the inner witness of the Holy Spirit, just begun walking with God, witnessed to him in the state of Florida, and sent me to Scott Depot, West Virginia, where we've had one of the most wonderful ministries ever known in the earth.
Yes, sir.
Ever known in the earth.
Yes, the Lord.
And how thankful we are for that.
Amen.
So, and that's upset people. People say, well, why didn't you get the word from God? If I had waited on God, as I should have had from my conversion, perhaps the Lord would have told me. But I do remember that the Lord witnessed to told Paul, he said, spoke to him on the Damascus Road. Then he said, you go into Damascus to get your instructions as to what you're going to do.
Yes, sir.
And he wasn't used to being told what to do.
No,
he did his own thing. He got his own orders, and except from the ecclesiastical apparatus, and that doesn't seem to bother people when you get your orders from them. But don't get them from a man of God that waits on God. But the Lord told Saul, said, now, told him, spoke to him. Now, why didn't he tell him the rest? Well, I tell you, it takes more humility and greater grace and faith to receive your orders through someone else. Like my wife was receiving the witness that we should go out into the ministry, and I wasn't getting anything. My way was paid to seminary. And I could be stubborn and bullheaded and very carnal about it. But on August the 31st, 1966, we prayed with brother, and he thought, like I did, that I should just stay in school. But when he prayed, the Holy Spirit said, no, you're not going to school this fall. My wife knew that's what it was. She knew I wasn't going to school this fall. Jesus had been talking to her. Yeah. Now, she was saved as a matter of days.
Yes, sir.
Now, how difficult do you think it is for a minister that's been preaching at that time more than 10 years for God to tell his wife something that he didn't tell me? Well, I soon learned for it not to be difficult. If we believe the report and we have confidence in another person that walks with God, then if God witnesses to them, they're walking with God, then we can move with assuredness and with safety and with help. But once I received this $25 raise, and I was so excited about it. And he said to me, strictly between him and me and Jesus, he said, he was quiet. And I've watched him sometimes when he gets quiet. It means things. And I thought, uh-oh, what have I told him? And he prayed a little bit, and he said, but Oliver, Jesus tells me it should have been $75. I said, what? $25 a week was a wonderful raise. Now, 1 year later was when Ron Kirk was praying. 1 year later, I should have had $75 more. 1 year later, when Ron Kirk was praying, he started up. He's operated on this morning, and Jesus is helping him. But he was praying, and he started. Some of you were on the board. I think some of the men were on the board. Yeah, Otis, he started praying. 5, 10, 15, 20, 50, 60, and then they said he got white and began to tremble. And he got to 75, and when he got to $75, the Holy Spirit witnessed 75. He says, boys, brothers, he said, they tell me, he said, I've just heard from Jesus. Bob, you were there in that meeting.
Oh, yeah.
Joe, you were in that meeting. There's three of them right there, Board of Trustees members right there. And he said, I've just heard from Jesus. And only one man was upset. He left me. But he was upset with me long before this revelation ever came. But I didn't tell them. Brother, the Lord helps him to handle revelations discreetly. There's times when he'd like to spare somebody from an accident. Or you remember there at the home, Brother Helm, in Dad's place, God revealed to you that somebody would be killed in about 17 days, right? So many rods, right out through there.
Yes, sir.
And I was at the table with Daddy. But you said, Everett, there's nothing we can do about it. You could have alarmed the community. You could have said, now there's going to be an accident out here. But that wasn't wisdom. God wouldn't let him do it. But if the village had known that a man of God was in the place, they could have been spared this awful accident.
Yes.
17 days later, I was sitting at the table with my daddy. It's right after we met Brother Helm. 17 days later, and a telephone rang. It was one of the parishioners, and they said there's been an awful head-on collision out here, and the young people were playing chicken, and neither one of them gave, and they hit head-on, and I think three were killed. One was severely injured, may have died later, well, turned to a vegetable, and they were killed. And I went back to the table. I said, Daddy, Sister So-and-so says someone's had an accident out here, an awful accident, just beyond the graveyard. And Daddy thought of me. He said, oh, son, Brother Helm told me. God told Brother Helm right here at this table where it would take place. And he counted the days. He said, just exactly the number of days, Dad, if you remember. I may not be, am I on the day, 17?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. And the number or whatever we had the days going then. Anyway, it was exactly the time that this would take place. So he had a revelation that he could not give because many people, most people don't believe. They just won't believe. So I think we're awfully privileged for him to share very sacred things, and that it's in our interest to believe and to be encouraged about it. Those of us who've walked with him have been real thrilled because we knew some things that as we watch them unfold, we say, oh, that's what God told Brother Helm. Glory to God. We're thrilled about it.
Somebody has back trouble. Someone's got back trouble. It's right here.
Just told me that second.
Wonderful.
Right here. It's a peculiar thing.
It's right here in the middle of the... Right here. Give Jesus all the glory. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, behold, be healed. Jesus healeth thee, delivereth thee. Jesus delivereth thee. Jesus the Christ delivereth thee. Receive it with thanksgiving. Behold, be healed, be well. Be encouraged. Thank you, Jesus. Just praise Jesus for this.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So thankful.
Thank you, Jesus.
Always praise Jesus. When a doubt or unbelief comes, they get hints in the name of Jesus. Happens to everybody. Happens to me, too. I have to resist Satan telling him to get hints. Well, God's giving me the revelation. Satan will be right there and say, it's not going to work. You don't know anything about that. I tell him he's a liar. Oh, yeah. You say, Brother Helm, you don't have trials. Oh, yes. Severe ones. I just have to tell him he's a liar. When it comes to mind, just say, get hints, Satan. I'm believing Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Yes. It's through Jesus that we're saved and cleansed and filled with the Holy Spirit and made well. So the Christ of God. Hallelujah.
And so we can believe the revelation, Brother Helm.
Yes.
That's what I was talking about.
Yes.
So we can just believe.
Yes.
Be encouraged and healed by God's grace.
Oh, yes.
Praise the Lord.
Well, I tell you, my heart was sad that day when he told me, he came upon me. He told me that awful thing was going to take place right out there. He told me where it was. We were having a wonderful meeting. Fellowship, you know.
Yes.
Suddenly just came upon us. At pace to serve Jesus. It's by God's grace we can take one step or one breath. Sir Jesus, all the way my Savior leads me. Isn't it precious?
Oh, yes.
It certainly is. Hallelujah.
We went to the hospital, Brother Helm, and there was awful tragedy in the air.
Oh, yes.
Can you imagine the hurt of mothers and fathers?
Oh, it's just beyond my comprehension.
Can you imagine what people would be spared if they would believe the servants of God?
Did they believe?
If they believe the Holy Spirit, if they wait on God, but they're determined, they're hard-headed. They said, well, I've got to know it myself. Well, that's a good way to go to hell. It's a good way to run into a brick wall. It's a good way to die. Me, I would rather wait upon him, believe the report of God's servant, and be led. Our song was looking led.
Yes.
See, they wouldn't believe the report. Moses stuck the serpent up there, and yes. I'd really upset people today.
Oh.
Let a Moses stick a brazen serpent up there and tell them if they'll look, they'll live.
Yeah.
Boy, let them figure that out theologically before the Christ had ever come. Let them try that on for size. Oh, I tell you, old heart, carnal hearts, and so they were bitten by the snakes, and they wouldn't do it, so they just died. But some looked up.
Yes, sir.
Said, I don't understand it, but that's what the servant of God said. And they looked up and they were healed.
They lived. They lived. Yes, sir. They lived. Praise the Lord.
Glory. Hey, glory.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, we're indebted to thee, Jesus. We owe thee everything.
Amen.
Let's see your protection, your healing, your guidance and blessing, and all things we owe to thee, Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord.
The living church, empower, thine ancient might reveal. Give wisdom for this crucial hour, and in thy mercy, heal. God of the living church, we plead, bestow thy mighty power. Thy loving presence, Lord, we need to save us in this hour.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is His new creation, by water and the victorious shall be the church at rest. How firm a foundation, O church of the Lord, is laid for your faith in His omnipotent hand. Glorious things of thee are spoken. Church from heaven came with God's seal that can't be broken. I through grace a member am.
Ages found, and glorious things of thee are spoken. God of heaven, with thy
bless upon my church we pray. O breath of life, come sweeping through us, revive thy church with life and power.
O breath of life,
come cleanse, renew us, and fit thy church to meet this hour.
19 centuries ago, the price of admission to the church all too often was torture and suffering and death. And this grim knowledge weeded out the weak and discouraged and hesitant. Now, little or no sacrifice is required. And sometimes we tend to regard that which costs little as having little or no value. Christians of today, take hold. You are the church. Be strong as men of old. Worldwide church revival must come. Move with the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Live positively. March on. Rise up. Rise up, O Church of God. Have done with lesser things. Give heart and soul and mind and strength to serve the King of Kings. Rise up, O men of God, the church for you.
Praise thee, for what our ears has heard, our hearts have known, and for this hour, and for this which has been given for thee, which has required gifts and talent in many years of musical practicing, application. Because they revealed to us that they were to sing, I didn't know what was their list. You said 29. We didn't know that it was going to be so magnificent, so great. Really told a great story to all of us. Declared a marvelous declaration about thy church, about thy will and thy kingdom.
Uh, I was thinking, Jesus, as they were bringing this to us, Dalton Ellie, it would require quite a lot of rehearsing to ever get such a number. And it would require a lot of study to be able to play this, the persons to sing it, and then to rehearse their coming in and presentation. And yet, here today, we were blessed in a moment, in an hour. It's only thee could do this, two persons that are gifted, that are led by the Holy Spirit. Thee led it, or it could not be done like this. Thankful to thee, Lord Jesus, for this beautiful story, this beautiful word we have heard. Sanctify it to our memory. I know that, Jesus, when you were in the earth, the persons could not hear what you were saying. So unless we're very close to thee and broken and yielded, very yielded, we will not perceive this message. Otherwise, not able to evaluate the sounds we heard, the truth, the word that was given, the music that was presented, requiring years of study to do this extemporaneously. So we bless thee. We bless thee and we thank thee for these gifts and for this great truth that came through thy vessels, thy instruments. They were just finished singing number 29. They will now sing for Jesus number 14. And this fits right in.
Oh, In death's dark veil, I'll fear no ill. With thee, dear Lord, beside me, thy rod and staff my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me. Thou spreadst a table in my sight, thy unction grace bestoweth, and all the transport of delight with which my cup o'erfloweth, and so through all the length of days my goodness faileth never. Good Shepherd, may I sing thy praise within the
Jesus. Magnificent. Marvelous. If someone had planned this for a long, long time. There was never no one until just minutes ago. So far as this service was concerned. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Have we been able to perceive what we have been in? How long would it require walking with God to realize where we have been? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Have we been able to perceive what we have been in? How long would it require walking with God to realize where we have been? How many years of obedience would it require to perceive the sacred place where we've journeyed and where we stand and where we dwell here? Praise the Lord. It's through Jesus. It's through the Holy Spirit. We only are able to perceive as He gives us that perception. That is by His Holy Spirit, by His love, His word, His revelation to His children that love Him. That love Him with all their heart. Otherwise, we take it lightly. Take it as just another little part. Or could you hear me? It was worth more than the day. What we have heard, worth more than today.
Immediately following, Reverend Daniel Light presented the message, "And I Saw the King," included in its entirety on cassette number 10. We now begin with selections from the evening session on June 24.
And it works. It's real. It's never tiring. You never get tired of this. They always say, well, how could tomorrow be better than today? How could it?
Well, it can. By God's grace, through Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, it can. That's all. But it's so wonderful, we wonder how it could be. Glory to God. We're just thankful. Here we are in the ninth session. I think we've gone, all of them have gone into the third hour, into the fourth hour. Maybe one session might not have lasted 3 hours. I'm not sure about that. But most of them have gone 3 to 4 hours. And maybe one a little over that. But God has just been so sweet and so precious and such love and such tenderness. Yes, his love, you know. People being healed and helped and their lives changed and God forgiving them for neglect and disobedience and slaying out the carnal nature and coming in with his precious sweetness, his Holy Spirit. They may live a life of true obedience, consistent obedience to God. Praise his wonderful name, saith my soul. Hallelujah. And he cares.
Yes. He's faithful.
Always.
True.
He wants us to be faithful always. I was in prayer in about 1944, 45. I was praying. There's a little plaque right back of the couch where I was praying. It says, Jesus never fails. He said, I'm seeking a people will not fail me by my grace.
Yes.
He wants us by his grace to not fail, but to trust and obey him. I've never forgotten it.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you. That brought it to my mind.
Yes. I have a plaque like that in my home.
You do?
Yes.
I see it now in memory. Jesus never fails. We used to sing that when I was first converted 43 years ago. We would sing as a group of young people. Jesus never fails. See, he wants a people who will not fail him by God's grace. See, a lot of people say, well, we've got to fail all the time. See, that's the wrong thing. He's seeing a people that by God's grace, he'll warn them if they start to fail, if they're in hearing distance. See, he'll check them. See, he'll lead. He'll say, no, don't say that. Here, this isn't my order. See, then when we do that, we go right over the top of his grace and we disobey. See, he tries to lead everyone from conversion. He's never left anyone but what he wanted to lead them from the first second of conversion, the first minute. And this testimony of yours has just brought this to my mind. Wonderful. See, Jesus said, testimony. I said, Lord, is it over here? Here, over here. He said, right over here. I said, well, what pew is it? He said, six. I said, just keep passing it down. By God's grace, what do we know? Again, praise the Lord. See, when the Lord helps, it just helps us. It certainly does. See, he'll do as much in any one moment as any other moment if we're just willing in that moment to let him have all of us with our minds clear and pure without hesitant doubts and reservations and unbelief. You see? See, when I look at a man's face, I can tell whether he's doubting or he's believing the way he looks. There's a scripture. There's a scripture straight in this area. There's a scripture on someone's heart right through here. Right in here. Where is that scripture? Yeah. That's right. Yes. Joseph, is it on your heart, son? Praise the Lord. God anointed this precious son a while back at a church a few hundred miles away. Really anointed him. Oh, I got word how God anointed him. Oh, they had a great meeting. It was wonderful.
Yes, it really was.
Oh, yes. They said the Spirit of Jesus was on the scene. God was there. There was praying at the altar. There was some precious victories.
I'm just locating the scripture here.
Very good.
It's been on my heart.
Now, when you say it's on your heart, see, it comes right and touches my heart. I just continue to marvel that when someone tells me something in the Holy Spirit, that Jesus would privilege me, give me the high privilege of knowing about that. I'm very, very thankful.
And when you started to come around, my heart pants or did a flip-flop.
And see, I went all around here like this, 400 some people, and yet Jesus is right here, to here. And his heart did something.
Yeah, it just sort of
flipped a little bit. Something
right.
Like that. Oh, how wonderful the Holy Spirit is.
You know, you learn a lot of lessons when you're in this place. And so often I'd get something on my heart, and I think that was the time to share it, and I'd be ready to go, and it'd be someone else. And then, you see, when I wasn't thinking about it...
Right back.
Then there it was, right there.
There it was, when you were at least expecting it.
See, all of my life, I had heard the Great Commission was the great goal of Christianity. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every living creature. And the efforts, brother, I've been with some of the best witnessing techniques. And I've worked with them, and I've seen souls come to Jesus. But when it got down to eternity, when it got down to those souls that were going to make it and stay true, I found that no matter what the technique, it was only when the Holy Spirit was in us that they lasted. And when I read that scripture in John, Jesus said, I pray that they may be one as you and I and the Father are one. Why? Why? That the world might believe. That is the fulfilling of the Great Commission. That is the only way that we'll ever get the world to believe. That's the only way. It's the only way. When I saw that, all of my desire, all of my fret and my worry, because I'd been told if you don't win souls, you're not following after Jesus like he wants you to. As if bearing souls. But you see, it's always Jesus. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw them unto me. And the burden of that trying to pull souls into the kingdom was on me so heavy. Yet I didn't know what to do. Because I'd get out there and I'd share. And we'd go out on our bus route. And we'd be with those little kids. And I'd come back in the summer. And they'd be worse off than they were before. I could not grasp how the God of all the ages could let a little child slip back. Well, you see, the truth of the matter was that I had been the one that begun. And therefore, when I left, it ended. In fact, it would end even if I was there. So when I caught this vision of being one, being one.
Oh, that's it. Oh, that I'm so glad.
First of all, for Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Because he wants to walk with us like he did Adam.
Oh, yes.
Jesus, when the scribes and the Pharisees came and asked him about Moses and the divorce, Jesus appealed to the garden experience as an authoritative review.
Yes, help us to hear.
He said it was not like that in the beginning. Because they, see, Moses said, give him a writing of divorcement. But Jesus says, from the beginning, the two shall be one.
Yeah.
And it was that way in the garden. Proving that the garden experience, through the reference of our Lord, was referred to as an ultimate walk with God.
Wonderful.
And Jesus came down that we might walk with him.
Oh, yeah, it's in my heart.
Like Adam.
Yes.
Oh, and like
Eve. It touches me.
And when I read how God came and walked with him the cool of the evening. Oh, brother, that does something to my soul.
Oh, yes, sir, it does.
The naming of the animals, the filling of the fruit, the gathering of the fields, and looking across the plains, and the beautiful rivers that flowed throughout. When we walk with God like that, where we can come through the streams and the cool waters,
And Jesus is walking hand in hand, arm in arm, with his arm around us, saying, Son,
yes.
Here. Now let's do it this way right here.
Yes, that's right.
And the world sees a oneness. They see Jesus in us and us in Jesus.
Yes.
They believe.
Yes, they do.
They believe.
Yes, praise the Lord.
So I'm just so thankful that you're waiting on God.
Yes, sir.
You see, in waiting on God, we come to the place where discipline, where Bible reading, where prayer, where praise, where loving actions and reactions and attitudes, where they're not forced, but where they flow.
That's it.
When I read in your book, In the Waiting on God, that I used to read, you said I started reading 1 to 10 to 20 chapters a day. You said I didn't do it because I had to. I did it because it was a delight.
Yeah.
And when I saw that I would have to give myself to the people of this world in the same manner, in the same fashion, in that extent, the all, as you do and as the men of God do here, I saw that I could not make myself do it.
Yes.
I could not make myself. I could not make myself get up in the mornings. I could not make myself read diligently. I could not make myself. I just had to come before God and wait and cry out and listen and just let myself be used by Him and alone where nobody was until when I was with people. It can flow out of me. Just flow like a river.
That's it. Touches my heart.
And brother, one of the greatest experiences of my heart was the other night. And I was at a little party. And in walked one of the men that was responsible, partly responsible, but he carried such an influence for me not getting a pastor down in Oklahoma. And then he walked, and I was face to face with a man who has been dabbling in my life, even though he didn't know me to that extent. And when I could look him in the face, and there would be nothing, absolutely nothing, but love roll out of that heart of mine, I knew it was Jesus.
Glory, glory, glory to Jesus.
And the hate that used to roll forth for even a little thing at times in my life was tremendous.
Yes, sir.
That, you see, is the least a start toward being one because Jesus was that way.
Yes, He was.
He was on the cross. When His ministry was stifled, He only looked with love.
Only looked with love.
I count it a great privilege to find somewhere men of God. Because you see, I haven't been with you as much as I've been with my father and Oliver and some of the men here. I haven't been to the waiting on God as much as I've been to Anderson Camp Meeting. It's just been to find a few men somewhere that would bring this message to our hearts that we might begin to come to the place where Jesus could get in our hearts, show us ourselves,
yes,
pull out of those little things which would hinder the love of God flowing through.
Yes, sir.
Because if we'll be faithful and we'll be true,
yes,
one of these days,
in my heart, I'm true to Him.
He's going to turn the power switch. There will be everybody here. Jesus helping, the kingdom will come. And it be because we have waited until there's nothing in our life that will hinder that flow.
Praise the Lord.
We have to reach that place.
Praise the Lord.
And become one.
Yes, sir.
That the world might believe.
So true.
I love you.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. Praise the Lord. 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 Thank you, Jesus.
You know, something just came to me right there. Oh, it got in my heart. It just operated with me. Yes, it did. Praise the Lord for that. I like Diane and Gary, that Reverend Ryan and his wife come up with all of his family and sing a song like with Amazing Grace or some little song. They've never done this before, but that doesn't make a difference. Come on up, Reverend Ryan, Reverend Miss Ryan. And, the girls are kind of holding. Yes, that's good. It can be done. We'll get Steve up here to help you, and we'll get Daniel up here if it's necessary. Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, yes, Deborah. Oh, yes, she's a part of the family.
Yes, she's part of the family.
Yes, she is.
The twins aren't here.
Oh, the twin. Oh, we missed the twin daughters. Oh, those lovely daughters couldn't come. They wanted to be here. I know they did. Oh, they're so sweet. Just come right on up, darling. Praise the Lord. Oh, yes. 21. Doesn't seem like only ought to be 16.
Which we sing, Deb?
Which song will we sing?
So thankful God touched Mother.
I'm so thankful what Jesus doing with the family.
Yeah,
everyone.
Praise the Lord. We just praising the Lord to Deborah saying we're so thankful what Jesus did for her mother. Touching her, yeah. Encouraging her family. Praise the Lord. Do you have any particular guidance on what song that you all could sing?
Never done this.
No, they've never done this at home, probably. So this is going to be new. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what. Hallelujah. Donna, would you like to testify? You know, the first time that I was with this family, was April 23, 7 years ago last. When I walked into that church, I looked around to see if I had any friends there. I had one. That's the handmaid right here. I never saw her before. I said to my song evangelist, I talked to him this evening in Springfield. I said, I have a friend here. He said, I see that. I said, I have a friend here. She was so delighted.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, I was delighted the first night I saw Brother Helm, and I've just become more delighted and more delighted. It's wonderful how God has led down through the years since we met Brother Helm. I tell you, I wish I could just go over and review all the way that God has blessed, how he's blessed in our family alone, and how he has given us two precious son-in-laws. They're really our sons.
That's right.
And I'm looking forward to four more these days.
They're coming in. They're coming in. Right. It's going to be great.
God has given us such a precious congregation. They are so special. And I know it's because of Brother Helm's obedience. And God has sent him every year since we've been in Oklahoma. Now that's something. It really is, because we're in a little town of, if we count the dogs and everything, we've got probably 1,100. And if you'd see the town, it's a little oil town, that's the name of it. Well, it's just one that boomed during the oil period, but now there's just not much there. But God has built a beautiful edifice, and it's to his glory.
Lovely.
I mean, to have a church like that, an area like that, you have to say, well, to God be the glory. He's the one that did it. And he started a school. You know, a lot of people in our town think we're just crazy, you know, starting a school in a little town like that. But, oh, God, God has blessed our children through our school. One woman came in, and she saw our children. Our Brother Schultz, he was there. And she says, why, these children look like angels. She couldn't imagine. These children were so sweet, and they looked so precious. And if she saw the school and saw the Spirit of God working, she could understand why our children looked like angels. So, I tell you, we're indebted to God. We're indebted to Brother Helm. I tell you, it's a miracle. It's a miracle that God led us to him. We marvel. We marvel how God let Bill and I, we're just nothing. We're just nothing in the kingdom. We marvel that God just led us to Brother Helm, and we're so thankful. I tell you, we're thankful. And how God has blessed in Oilton, how he's blessed our people, how our people are striving to be obedient.
Amen.
And you know, in
74,
just a couple years ago, as I was praying, the Lord showed me that there would be men coming in to stand around my husband. I just coveted men to back up my husband.
Yes.
And God just showed me he's going to send men, and I saw him coming from every direction. And he's been doing that. He's been sending men in, and I tell you, they stand around him. And before every service, they meet in the study. And I tell you, they get a hold of God. They go into the sanctuary with him. They sit on the pulpit with him. And boy, they're behind him. And it's wonderful. It's no wonder God is blessing, because he's given us men who will stand behind their pastor and will listen to the pastor and be obedient to the pastor. No wonder God's blessing. And I praise God for our men. And you know,
glory to God.
The other week, that when my husband was called to Michigan, when his uncle was so ill, and then he passed away, and you know, our men just took over. And even though my husband wasn't there, they met in the study. They prayed, and I tell you, as we sat in that front row, and the men marched in, I tell you, we felt such a strength. Oh, we felt a strength and a power as our men marched in. So I'm thankful to be a part of this fellowship. I tell you, it's wonderful. Man, it's wonderful. It's wonderful to stand with Brother Helm, and I want to be faithful. I want to be faithful to stand with him. I want my husband to be faithful, to stand with him and hold up his arms. And by God's grace, I want to be faithful in prayer to hold him up and not let him down. It's a privilege to be here. It's a privilege to be a part of the family. And I'm thankful our children love God. I'm thankful. And it's because I know of it, because they've heard the message of Brother Helm. And they've heard it and listened to it, and they love him with all their heart. So it's a privilege to be here.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. I tell you, you talk about rich. Glory to Jesus of Nazareth. Praise his wonderful name.
And I also want to say I'm thankful for, this is Debbie Jones. Yes. She's been with us and lived with us 2 years. And I'm thankful for Debbie. She's just another one of our daughters. And she's worked in the church. She teaches in our school. She's a song leader. And she's just gotten in and helped us like one of our daughters. And I'm thankful for Debbie.
Oh, that's so precious. Oh, my. Say, we've had church right up here, too. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. See, if I hadn't been impressed to bring them up here, what we would have missed. This witness, this exhortation, this testimony. Oh, say. Praise the Lord. Isn't it wonderful?
Amen.
It is. It is joy. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, you can just come right up close here and we'll get the microphones. There's one, Diane and Gary. There's a microphone there, so one of you or two of you can have one there. Come right up there and kind of lead out. Lord bless your hearts. I tell you, we've already heard the song. The song of truth and testimony.
Amen.
Thank you.
Glory to God.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
The day the Lord revealed to me over 7 years and 3 or 4 months ago that I was to call Brother Brian and tell him that I was to come to his church was one of the most difficult things I ever did. Not the most, but one. Because I'd only met him just the previous summer at Anderson Campground. We had such a precious time there. And here we were on the campground having such a precious fellowship. Up came Reverend McCall, and he said, "I want you to meet my precious brother here." I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "This is Reverend William Ryan," and I shook hands. Praise the Lord. We had a time right there for about a minute or two, and he said, "Say, I just want to tell you, put me on your list. If God ever leads you to me, let me know." He told me that in about 2 to 3 minutes. And then just after he told me that, why, there's other meetings going on, or we were talking to people. And after all those months, and I would pray, and I said, "Well, Jesus, you have a word for me." And I went here, and he said, "I want you at Ashland, Kentucky." Oh, I can't convey to you what powers of darkness tried to prevent me from going. I couldn't convey. I could tell you, but the power of enemy would say, "No, you can't do that. You will not be wanted there." And with such dry but hard words at me, and I had to say, "Get him, Satan. I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to call and tell this precious brother that Jesus wants me there." And I just pressed right through it. I had to come up an awful steep grade. About that steep. About that steep. I tell you, if you ever come up a steep grade like that, that's an awful steep grade to go up, spiritually speaking. Because most grades, spiritually speaking, is on the level. It's on the level. And seldom do you have to encounter anything like that in the leading. Seldom. Seldom. It's usually right there. That's where most all persons in the church are called to obey. And you see, when it comes on up and on up. Now, right there, you see, that's fairly difficult, but you come right on up, and the enemy's still fighting, and he's still battling. And right there, see, I only know in my heart. See, he tells me like a compass. And I had to press. Oh, the Lord, help me. I couldn't listen to the flesh of the devil or the earth. Because it's the way it's been for 43 years. I could not listen to what anything said to me when the Lord showed me I must do what Jesus said, regardless of what anybody thought or what the earth said. I had to press right on and do it by God's grace. And he has never failed me. And he never will. My cry is that by God's grace, we will not fail him. That's been the cry for a long, 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 long time in my life. So I got him on the phone. Precious Brother Ryan. And when I got him on the phone, I said, told him, he said, "Now, just who do you say you are?" So I tried to tell him. He said, "Well, where did I meet you?" Well, I said, well, he couldn't remember me. He's only with me. See, there was thousands of people there, just 1 to 2 minutes. It was something like 1 to 2 minutes. Might have been just a few seconds over or under. It's under two minutes, just a little under. He said, "Well, when did I see you?" So I took him back to Anderson Campground when Reverend McCall, his precious brother, brought him up to us. And we were having a little time of fellowship. And he said, "Brother, put me on that list. That when God ever leads you to my place, you let me know." And I began to tell him. He said, "Now it's faintly coming back to memory. I can just faintly remember this. It's coming back a little more." And of course, when I told him the powers of the air was fighting so severely because the enemy and the earth did not want me to come to our brother and his family. And he had been many times hurt and disappointed in life. And one time he was in a wonderful meeting in Michigan. It was a great meeting, and he felt like the meeting should close, but they pressed him to go on one more night. And when they pressed him to go on one more night, some man came in and got out of order and just tore the thing up. And
course, when that happens, you know, the enemy can come back. And, you know, when I call, why, the enemy would whisper over the past disappointments. You see? Can you understand? See, it'd be a tremendous thing. Because he didn't know. See, he didn't know yet. See, he was just, he was, as it were, alone in the world, just pressing best he could. Yes, pressing the best he could. And we were to find him. We were to get to him.
So I said, Jesus has revealed to me that I'm to be there on April the 20th. See, if he hadn't told me that, in that 1 to 2 minutes, I would never be with them. I never would have been in Ashton, Kentucky. We'd missed Jack and Loretta. We'd have missed all the people in Arlington. And family after family after family after family. He told me, how serious is it when you're talking to someone in the second minute, what you're going to say? What all is going to depend on that in that 1 minute? Whenever you speak to a servant of God, what's going to happen in that 1 to 2 minutes? So how much of eternity is going to depend upon that? How many souls are going to be involved in this? See, he asked me to do this from the time I was with him 1 minute until the second minute, a little under. And I went home and scratched that down on my little pad.
I was quite sure, Brother Helm, that I had the leadership of God. When I said that to him, I wasn't just talking.
That's right. He really meant it.
I really meant it.
Oh, I knew it. Right.
Call,
yes, sir.
And he'd shared with me.
Right.
And, I was looking forward to having you come. I wanted
you. And so when we called, it took a while for him to get us located. Because it had been months, and he couldn't remember us. And then the pressures of the air was telling him that things is going to not be so good. You know, they were trying to holler at him, just like they would you or anyone else to get an opportunity. And so he called Reverend McCall and told him, and Brother McCall said these words. I quote him. Brother Bill, if the Holy Spirit has told Reverend Helm to come to you and your church, then your life and your church will never be the same again.
Exactly.
He says, that's exactly. So we arrived there, April the 23rd. The Lord began to work. He began to bless.
Been working ever since.
See, we'd have missed Jack. We would have missed him. And he was waiting on us. See, we were on his trail for years when he was a boy. I was right heading for him, too. Because he had been disappointed and crushed and bruised in the gears of this life by professed church people. Afraid of people in the church, frightened. Oh, how we people in the church need to watch what we say and what we do. Because so many times the people in the church, they talk in the flesh. They don't mean to, maybe. But we say things in the flesh and do harm, and we hurt people. We grieve them. We want to be sure we don't do that. So that the inside, if we're not careful, keeps the outside outside by our behavior and what we say or do not say on the inside. And when Jesus brings that inside to oneness as the Father and the Son, then he brings all the outside to come in to get what the inside has. And so it was through that guidance, that victory. There was wonderful victories. Well, the pianist was healed one night at the piano before we ever started. Pain and suffering. Jesus came right down. We were up there, and they were healed right there. Yes. But the piano, where my wife was. I never will forget that. Yes, sir. Of course, my wife was our pianist, but well, this person was there and had some part. And God healed this person right there, up by the piano, before the service ever started. Well, maybe he wants to begin that, but it began anyhow. Began anyhow. And because the Lord led us there to them, and the Holy Spirit revealed to me after I was there a few days, it came out of me and said, now, if the leaders of this church fail to obey the Holy Spirit, then the pastor will not be here too long. I didn't know it was coming out of me. I didn't know it was going to be said, but the Spirit of God spoke through me. Because I have prayed for many years to be God's spokesman wherever I am. So that whatever he wants to say, we will be his instrument, that Jesus may be exalted. And that the kingdom of God may be an evidence and his love known, and his truth given, as Jesus would present it. So the Holy Spirit came with power and helped us in the meeting. It was wonderful. The burden was great there, as it is in most places. One night I was so exhausted that when I went to the room, I had calls and calls. I was calling and talking to Thomas that night. Other calls that were urgent, needs. I have needs and little slips of paper in my pocket now. They're serious. And while I was on the telephone, finally I was out just for a moment or two and he could ring me. And he said, "Oh, Brother Helm, I want you to pray for Loretta. She's been burned since church." She went home and was preparing French fries, and the grease caught fire and caught the curtains, and she took the curtains right off over the sink and carried them out through the kitchen, the back room, and didn't catch herself on fire, or that is her hair, but it was a fire here and through the arm. But see, it's a marvel to me yet how she was not catching fire, because she had one of those beautiful hairdos, and it was large. But God didn't let that fire get there. Really, I'm still marveling at this. It was so serious to me. It burned the cupboards a little around, didn't it? And she just took the whole thing out. It was a fire, and yet she was not burned too badly. And when he said, "I'd like for you just to have a little prayer for her," I said, "I'll be right out." He said, "But you're too tired." I said, "Well, I'm tired, but right as of now, I'm on my way, just a moment. But you're not feeling so good." And I said, "No, but I'm coming. God's sending me." He said, "Wonderful, we'll be waiting on you." Roger and the pastor were ready, and we made our way out in the country a little bit to their home. I want to tell you, there was Loretta lying there burning. Did you ever burn in a little spot like that?
Sure.
She was burning through the neck here and her arm. Pam, you know, if you just get a little burn, it hurts. But when you get a burn of some area like that, it's worse. I trust I'll never be burned that way. There's a slight little burn on me, hurts. It's a slight little something on my thumb or my finger or my hand. And we walked in there, and of course I hadn't seen Jack. I didn't know he was waiting on me. I didn't know I was to find him until I had gotten there for a while and sometime later. Listen, this is really important, to get where God wants you to go. Listen, he's got a lot of places for you people to get to go if you'll go. Oh, yeah, every one of you under the sound of my voice, you've got appointments in places if you would be willing. If you would. See, if you would. Yes, every person here has got some appointments, and it's usually when it's the most difficult on you. And you say, "Well, I can't make it. I can't do it." Most people fail their first and second appointment that God has for them. Most. I doubt if there's so few people that'll do what God wants them to do when it's difficult. Of course, we've been teaching you along these lines for years, so by God's grace, you've been persevering, so that by God's grace, if something comes up, I know by His mercy, can we make the next one. It's going to be by His strength. No merit, no strength of our own. We haven't that.
This sharing continued on tape number 12. Thank you.